It's a busy world. Everybody's life is very busy. And it's we get pulled so many different ways all the time. It's hard to, it seems like it's impossible, very difficult to find a moment's rest, hard to find calmness in the midst of this life that we have these days. So our practice is the how we find a calmness, continuous, our continuous practice is the way that we find calmness in the midst of our busy life, in the midst of our activity. We can find calmness. When our daily activities are based on calmness, we can feel satisfaction. And but on the other hand, if our activity is not based on calmness, we cannot find satisfaction in the things that we do. And instead, our activity will feel like a burden. And throughout the day, one activity will pile upon another activity. And over time, this pile up, we can become dissatisfied with our life and not understand why. And this dissatisfaction will lead us to feel that to find satisfaction, I should be doing something else. You know, when we're not finding satisfaction in the activities that we're doing, we feel, we believe, then I'm not doing the right activity. I should be doing some other activity. We feel we must do something else for satisfaction. And the risk there is that we turn inward and turn away from others. But of course, the dilemma is we are not understanding the cause or the source of our dissatisfaction. So our practice is to help us find calmness within our activity. Because without calmness in our activity, our mind becomes very excited or stays excited. Always whirring like a machine. And we get confused by this excitement. It throws us off balance so that we cannot see things as they are. A little bit of excitement in our lives is a good thing. We all need some stimulation like that. But when our mind is excited all the time, we cannot see things as they are. We cannot see things in a large sense, in the spiritual sense. And that's what we want, to understand our life spiritually and understand its meaning. But with excitement going on in our mind, we cannot see things in that way. And in addition, with excitement going on, it's very difficult to sort out the things of our everyday life, of our everyday world. So without calmness in our activities, various difficulties appear in our life, over and over again. And, you know, this is how we suffer. We keep creating our own difficulties, and this is the source of suffering. We suffer because we are not able to see the vastness of things, and we suffer because we don't recognize our own inherent calmness that's already there. So we learn little by little by sitting quietly this way, continuously, over time. We develop the capacity to find a calmness in our everyday activities. So if we cannot see our own purity, our inherent calmness, if we cannot see our inherent vastness, we will see things only in the relative sense, the objective sense. Seeing things only in that way leads us to have critical judgment about things, good and bad, and like and dislike, and that can lead to feelings of separation. So calmness is so important. The Zen teacher Dogen, who is the founder of this school of Zen, the Soto school, he said many things, and he had many thoughtful metaphors for us to chew on. And one of those, he described all worldly phenomenon as flashes of lightning, brief flashes of lightning that appear in the dark sky momentarily. All things, he said, all things that appear in the relative world are momentary brightness. They're transient, and they disappear very quickly. They are just a momentary display of some activity. He, of course, is likening our life and our activities to flashes of lightning that appear in the with the background of a vast sky. So Dogen meant that each thing, everything, is reflected against the sky, the calm, vast sky. And each thing, each flashing, expresses something vast, something calm, something unmoving, something undisturbed. Without the sky, without our awareness of the sky, we could not appreciate the lightning. And without calmness, we find it hard to appreciate our life. This is what he's trying to tell us. Suzuki Roshi had a similar kind of metaphor in one of his talks. He spoke about seeing stars in the dark sky. And he said, what we see is light or energy that's traveling from some phenomenal existence very far away. And it's traveling very fast. Lots of energy. But he said, when we see stars, we don't see them as speedy beings. We don't see the speedy activity of the stars. To us, they seem calm, steady, and peaceful. Isn't it peaceful to look up at the night sky, an uncloudy night sky, and see the stars just calmly glowing? He said, we don't see their speedy activity, just their peaceful nature. So our practice is to see all of our activity that way, to see each other that way, inherently peaceful and calm, even though there's lots of energy, lots of activity, despite how speedy we are, how active we are inherently, we have the background of that calm and peaceful sky. So it's not just philosophy. We really need to see things both ways. We need to see calmness, and we need to see activity. And not, you know, judge one against the other. We accept both, calmness and activity. In other words, like we chanted earlier, we understand our life from the standpoint of both emptiness and form. They are two different expressions of the same truth. When we see things that way, when we see people that way from the standpoint of both sides, that is our own calmness, to see things that way. That is our own enlightenment. Seeing the inherent calmness in each activity is to see the oneness of everything, where there is no separation. Because the mind will not create separation when it feels the calmness, when it feels its inherent calmness. So even though each one of us and all things in this world are different in their relative aspects, all things are inherently the same. And we express this truth in our Zazen practice. And so we say that when you sit, your neighbor also sits, even though the cushion next to you may be empty. When you sit, your neighbor sits, even though your neighbor may be at home in the early morning and you are sitting in the early morning. When you sit, your neighbor sits. When you sit, everything sits. And you are everything. Everything practices at the same time. This is the feeling you have in Zazen. It's a feeling of vastness and inclusiveness, oneness. Everything joined together in oneness. When we have that feeling, we understand calmness. By appreciating our inherent oneness, we can feel the inherent calmness of our existence. Our usual life, our everyday life, is a series of activities, one after the other, just like many lightning flashes, or like stars in the sky, and without the feeling of oneness, we cannot appreciate the sky, and we only see the very busy everyday life. If that's what we see, just a busy everyday life, activity after activity, life feels like a storm. So the famous Zen teacher Rinzai said something quite interesting. He said, one of the things he said, There's no such thing as an unenlightened person. No matter how hard you try, you can't find them. Now, this is quite different from our usual understanding of who is enlightened and who is not enlightened. Usually we say, no, I can't find an enlightened person no matter how hard I try. He said just the opposite. Because Rinzai sees the world from the standpoint of vastness. From his standpoint, enlightenment is inherent, not selective. Enlightenment is inherent in everything, everywhere, everyone. It is the background of everything. It is the sky. It exists before the lightning flashes. It exists before the activity of your life. So the meaning in his statement, no matter how hard you try, the meaning of that, it's the same as saying, no matter how hard you examine. Look for an unenlightened person, you can't find them, no matter how hard you try, no matter how hard you examine things. And usually our examining is in the relative world, in the speedy world. We examine things in the everyday world. And so we examine people to find someone who is enlightened. Is it you? Is it you? Is it him? And then we say, well, I can't find anyone. I examined everyone and I can't find anyone who's enlightened. But according to our practice, this examine that we do is from the view of the vast mind, from the calm mind. We don't examine from the standpoint of the everyday world, from our relative life. So the examine is not really examine when it's from the viewpoint of the vast and calm mind. Examine is really the understanding of inherent enlightenment. Our practice, spiritual practice, not just our practice, spiritual practice in everyday life is seeing the enlightenment in so-called unenlightened people. Seeing the enlightenment in so-called unenlightened people without examining them. Our practice is not complicated. It's very straightforward. It's easy. It's simple. It is so easy that many people say, well, that's nothing. You sit there, that's nothing. What's so complicated about that? You're sitting there doing nothing. Anybody can do that. What's the big deal? It's a misunderstanding to think that spiritual practice must be a big deal. If we think that way, then of course we expect it to be exciting in order to justify it being a big deal. Then we would expect a series of lightning flashes that never stopped. And we put emphasis on special activities. So if we look for a big deal in our practice, we will not know the meaning of our practice. calmness is what we express, not excitement. So our practice is based on the sky and understanding the relationship between lightning and the sky. The relationship between activity and calmness, and between ourself and oneness. Understanding this relationship. If we try to hold on to some old activity that we are fond of, it's like trying to hold on to some old flash of lightning. So, true spiritual practice is quite simple. It means we are continually expressing, continually resuming our oneness. We are continuing to express our vastness. Our practice will enable us to see the oneness of all things and the calmness within everything. And then we will be able to find calmness in the midst of even the speediest activity. This is the truth of life. This is the truth of our practice.